difficult assignment today. I can't pronounce upon the constitutionality of an amendment. I ceased to have that authority 3 years ago. Now, whatever I say today can at best be an opinion. And the second thing is, we have reached a stage in this country, irrespective of the truth, whatever. I hope I'm audible.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. You are audible.
Irrespective of the truth or jurisprudential soundness or philosophical proposition, we have come to believe in this country, at least we are made to believe in this country. What the Supreme Court says is always right, and any contrary opinion is not right. Though this problem always persisted in every jurisdiction, not only in this country. In fact, Professor Gopal, this is one quote which, though I'm not very fond of quoting, you must have noticed in my judgment, I'm not very one of those judges who quoted a lot. But this is one of my favorite quotes. He quoted,
yes, sir.
Lawrence Tribe, one of the greatest law, said, do not consider the judgments of the Supreme Court to be synonymous with constitutional is God, which claims to be non-persons and separate is equal, and pregnancy to be a non-sex related subject could either hardly be final or infallible. That's the quote of first right. Of course, the profundity of his scholarship comes in an example. But he says such passing is essentially a compromise between chaos. Well, we'll start with that anyway. So therefore, whatever we say is only submission or opinion. Now, coming to this proposition today, I think there is a little boom. Is it some problem?
There is a little
problem.
Maybe, sir.
Then kindly unmute all other learned jurists.
It's all done, sir. Sir, everything has been unmuted, sir. Everything is muted, sir. Everything is muted, sir. Sir, whether your microphone is near enough, sir, Justice Chalamet.
I'm holding my iPad in my hands.
Yes, sir. And
okay. And now I think it's better. Now it's better.
It's better, sir. Okay.
I request all the participants kindly to mute your phone.
I have muted everything, sir. I have muted everything as the host.
Mr. Rajan's phone is not muted. And Professor
Gopal,
Professor Rajan, not Professor Advocate Rajan.
Yes.
Please, Rajan, mute. Anyway, now, yes. My question is, when we get into this debate whether a particular amendment, of course, the amendment on hand, which is the subject matter of debate today, the economically weaker, reservations for economically weaker section, is opposed to the basic structure or not, we must have some clarity about what exactly is this theory of basic structure. Unfortunately, in my opinion, from 1973 onward, from Keshavananda Bharati, this has almost become a mantra. Repeatedly, people have been using this expression, basic structure, opposed to basic structure, without exactly settling what are the implications of what is meant by this basic structure. For example, you see the NJSE judgment, the whole thing proceeded on the basis that any interference with existing in the process of selection is opposed to the basic structure. What is the basic independence of the judiciary? The judgment now binding on all of us, that is standing my disagreement with the judgment. But the whole debate proceeded on the basis is opposed to the basic structure. Now, question is, what is this basic structure in the context of these reservations? Now, one of the propositions very clearly held, settled in the Keshavananda Bharati's case is equality is a part of the basic structure of the Constitution, the concept of equality. Now, when we talk about equality, those articles dealing with Article 14 to 18, in my opinion, all all of them compendiously deal with the concept of constitutional equality. While Article 14 makes a general declaration that the state shall not deny equality or equal protection of laws, 15 and 16 deal with certain facets of the equality, and 18 deals with the abolition of untouchability, so on and so forth, which is a great peculiarity of the Indian society. Therefore, sorry.
Justice Chelamishwar Anandam, the Supreme Court judge.
Hello. So, these are all the various facets of equality. Now, point is, all of them put together deal with the concept of equality. Similarly, when you're talking about reservation.
Sir, may I briefly interrupt, sir? Your face is not fully clear, sir. Oh. You're seeing only a small part of your face, sir. Slightly, sir.
I'll use my earphones, maybe. Maybe that will improve.
Yeah. No, your face is not. It's only half seen, sir. That's
now when we come to this question of is better.
Yes, sir. And the face is much better. Right.
Oh, face, thank of course, it won't improve with the earphones. Face remains what it is. By using earphones, that won't become any more glamorous. Now,
the voice is very, very, very clear, sir.
Okay. But that perhaps is the question. Anyway, now, the point is, when Articles 15 and 16, as originally drafted, as originally incorporated in the Constitution, mentioned about the authority of the state to make special provisions in the context of one article, it is backward classes. In the context of the other article, socially and economically backward classes, coupled with the corresponding provision of Article 340 or 41, I don't remember the number readily, which says the state shall take into consideration, consistent with the requirements of efficiency, appropriate representation for these backward classes. All these articles compendiously constitute a scheme of equality, and when the Keshavananda Bharati declared equality is a part of the basic structure of the Constitution, all these articles and the scheme of these articles, in my view, constitutes the basic structure. Now, if reservations are required to be provided as per the original constitutional theory and constitutional text document, these provisions were incorporated after a great deal of deliberation. All of you know here the number of sittings held by the Constituent Assembly for incorporating these particular provisions. Forget about the entire Constitution, these particular provisions and the elaborate debate that went on, and the kind of inputs that went into the incorporation of these particular articles, enabling the state to make special provisions. And what are all the inputs the Constituent Assembly took into account? The history of this country, the social structure of this country, the existing inequalities based on a hierarchical society, and therefore the need to give some kind of a protection, constitutional protection, and make special provisions for bringing those sections of the society who suffered a disadvantage because of the existing social order. These provisions were incorporated. They were simply not incorporated because one fine morning somebody got a brainwave that there should be reservations in this country. It is a result of a great deal of deliberation.
Raji, now,
Keshavananda Bharati says no part of the Constitution is beyond the amendatory power of the Parliament, wonderful. Everybody remembers that the Parliament has the power to amend any part of the Constitution, including the fundamental right. That's what everybody talks about. Fair enough, we have the thing. But then there must be some pattern. There must be a clear understanding while making a particular amendment, are we likely to that part of the Constitution, that part of Keshavananda Bharati saying don't touch the basic structure. That part of it, nobody is debating it. Reason is this. Economically weaker sections, as it sought to be incorporated today in the Constitution, rather incorporated already in the Constitution. Well, the optics part of it, Professor Venugopal, Professor Mohan Gopal is saying there was hardly any debate. That's one aspect of the matter. Well, apparently nobody has the patience to debate things nowadays. Everybody wants things to happen. Apart from that, economically weaker sections is a highly nebulous concept. When we talk about socially and educationally backward classes, there is a huge amount of historical data by which a section can be identified to be socially and economically backward. When you talk about economically backward, and then what are the, and the Constitution itself in the explanation, the amendment says in the explanation, on the annual income and so on, such other criteria, I mean, you just check up the language, such other criteria as may be determined. Now, if the annual income is to be the base, or other whatever other criteria the government is, or the state is going to employ for determining the economically weaker sections, now they are very, very transient phenomena. I may be very efficient today, economically affluent today. I'm comfortable, but I'm not affluent. But there is no guarantee that my next generation will be affluent. I might squander away whatever little money I have during my own lifetime, or my children may squander away. Their income levels would be less. But question is, this is such a transient thing. And if we start reserving opportunities, either educational opportunities or employment opportunities, on the basis of such transient criteria, nothing more profound than, you know, a passing this thing. We have no doubt there are a lot of people who are economically weak in this country. Now, of course, this is a question of interpretation, whether this quota of economically weaker sections quota would be available to the other socially and economically backward classes or not, I'm not very clear from the text of the Constitution, which requires a debate. Now, if that is the case, most of the people belonging to those classes would automatically qualify into this. That there are interpretation problems, I'm not going into it. The point is, once you say that economically weaker sections, this is certainly something which is very, very transient a proposition, on the basis of which we create a reservation, or a reservation is created. Would it be consistent with the settled principle of not to violate the basic structure of the Constitution? I have my grave doubts about it. Now, as I mentioned to you, I wouldn't like to make a pronouncement that is clearly unconstitutional. There's something, well, other than I had been a judge, then today I'm not, therefore I wouldn't like to make pronouncements today. I can only indulge in an academic debate. But this is an aspect which certainly requires a great deal. And second thing, as Professor Gopal was saying, kind of an amendment like this, which has far-reaching consequences, not only for the various economically and socially backward classes, to the entire society, either way, favorably or unfavorably to the whole society, it certainly required a much larger level of debate and a more profound debate than simply hustling through these matters through the system. And with these observations, I would like to hear others. Also, as I was mentioning, I am so tuned to hearing for the last 25 years in my life, and less tuned to speaking. I would rather like to hear people like Reverend Kumar, I mean, any lawyer or any student, I would like to hear them. Maybe I'll intervene at some stage if I have something to add. Thank you all for this great opportunity given to me.